morning, we're going to continue in our series, our Lenten series of messy people, merciful God, and we're going to continue in the book of Judges. And so this morning I invite you to turn to Judges 4 with me, Judges 4, and we're going to read the story of Deborah. From Judges chapter 4, hear these words from the Lord. After Ehud died, the Israelites once again did evil in the eyes of the Lord. So the Lord sold them into the hands of Jabin, a king of Canaan, who reigned in Hazor. The commander of his army was Sisera, and he lived in Herosheth Hagoyim, because he had 900 iron chariots, and he had cruelly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years. They cried to the Lord for help. Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lapidoth, was leading Israel at that time. She held court under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites came to her to have their disputes decided. She sent for Barak, son of Abinoam, from Kedesh in Naphtali, and she said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go take with you 10,000 men of Naphtali and Zebulun, and lead the way to the Mount Tabor. I will lure Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his troops, to the Kishon River, and I will give him into your hands." Barak said, "If you go with me, I will go. But if you don't go with me, I won't go." Barak said to her, "If you go with me, I will go." "Very well," Deborah said, "I will go with you. But because of the way you are going about this, the honor will not be yours, for the Lord will hand Sisera over to a woman." So Deborah went with Barak to Kedesh, where he summoned Zebulun and Naphtali, and 10,000 men followed him, and Deborah also went with him. Now Haber, the Kenite, had left the other Kenites, the descendants of Hobab, Moses' brother-in-law, and he had pitched his tent by the great tree in Zeranim, near Kedesh. When they told Sisera that Barak, the son of Abinoam, had gone up to Mount Tabor, Sisera gathered together his 900 iron chariots and all the men with him, from Herosheth Hagoyim to the Kishon River. Then Deborah said to Barak, "Go, this is the day the Lord has given Sisera into your hands. Has not the Lord gone ahead of you?" So Barak went down Mount Tabor, followed by 10,000 men. At Barak's advance, the Lord routed Sisera and all his chariots and the army by the sword, and Sisera abandoned his chariot and he fled on foot. But Barak pursued the chariots and army as far as the Herosheth Hagoyim. All the troops of Sisera fell by the sword, and not a man was left. Sisera, however, fled on foot to the tent of Jael, the wife of Heber, the Kenite, because there were friendly relations between Jabin, king of Hazor, and the clan of Heber, the Kenite. Jael went down to meet Sisera and said to him, "Come, my lord, come right in. Don't be afraid." So he entered her tent, and she put a covering over him. "I'm thirsty," he said. "Please give me some water." So she opened a skin of milk and gave him a drink, and then she covered him up. "Stand in the doorway of the tent," he told her, "and if someone comes by and asks you, 'Is anyone here?' tell them no." But Jael, Heber's wife, picked up a tent peg and a hammer and went quietly to him while he lay fast asleep and exhausted. She drove the peg through his temple into the ground, and he died. Barak came by in pursuit of Sisera, and Jael went out to meet him. "Come," she said, "I will show you the man you're looking for." So he went in with her, and there lay Sisera with a tent peg through his temple, and he was dead. On that day, God subdued Jabin, the Canaanite king, before the Israelites, and the hand of the Israelites grew stronger and stronger against Jabin, the Canaanite king, and they destroyed him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Today, I want to talk with you about expectations. All of us have expectations. Every day that we get up, we have an expectation of what the day is going to proceed like, the things that we might accomplish. Sometimes we go on vacations and we have expectations of what enjoyment and what fun we're going to have. Some of you are looking forward to vacation with expectations. We all have expectations in life, but the one thing that is true, whether our expectations are that things are going to be wonderful, or some of us have expectations that, you know, I don't want to get my hopes up, so I'm kind of a Debbie Downer, and I lower my expectations. But whether you raise them high or you lower them, no matter where you have your expectations, if you put all your hope in the expectations of what you're going to do and what is going to happen in your life because of the things that you're able to accomplish and the dreams that you have, all of your expectations are going to be met with sadness. Because it's never going to meet the expectations. You're going to have disappointment in life. And so this morning, I'm going to look at this passage as we go through Lent. And oftentimes, we go through Lent and we approach Easter, and we've done Easter so many times that we don't really go with any eager expectations because it's Easter. We do it every year. And the older you get, the faster it comes. And so here we are. We're going to celebrate Easter. This year it's early. Maybe next year it's late. That's the biggest thing. Is it early or late? Is the weather going to be nice? Are we going to be able to go outside? Easter introduces us and starts spring for most of us. But there is something about our expectation that is not right. And so this morning we're going to talk about expecting the unexpected. And so first we're going to look at what are some failed expectations in our story. If we were to read verse 29 of chapter 3, we would see that after Ehud, the judge, destroyed the enemy, there was peace in Israel for 80 years. 80 years. Peace. Meaning life was good. Things were going smoothly. Things were going well. People were happy. 80 years. There are only a few of us here this morning that know what it's like to live for 80 years. Most of us haven't even met that yet. And so you would expect that after 80 years of peace, that would continue. That it would just keep going, right? We got it figured out. We know what to do. Life is good. Let's keep it going. And then Ehud died. Remember last week I talked about the Israelites and we are in a sin cycle where sin just keeps spinning around in our life? As soon as Ehud died, as soon as he was no longer there to watch over and control them in some sort of manner or fashion, they once again returned to their evil ways. Life wasn't so good anymore. All of a sudden, that peace and that happiness disappeared, and the people cried out because suddenly God sold them. God handed them over to Jabin. Now, Jabin was not a king of a neighboring tribe outside the boundaries of Israel, the Promised Land. Jabin was a king who lived with people who used to be in the land. They were Canaanites. So the people that God kicked out so that Israel could take over the land and receive the Promised Land, he now sold Israel back to this King Jabin and his commander Sisera. Now it tells us that Sisera was a commander, and he had 900 iron chariots. 900. And they were oppressing the people cruelly. And so the people experienced this for 20 years, and it took them 20 years before they figured it out. And they cried out to God. Wait a minute. This isn't what we were expecting. This isn't what we wanted. Their expectations were that they were going to have a life of peace, a life of happiness, a life of success. But they were finding themselves being cruelly oppressed. Failed expectations. But there's someone else who had failed expectations. That was their God, Yahweh. Yahweh had expectations of his people when he brought him into the promised land. The expectation is that they would love him, that they would serve him, that they would honor him, that they would not serve other gods. And so he had failed expectations as well. The people were expecting peace. God was expecting honor and service. And neither of those expectations were being met. So we have failed expectations. Remember I said that we're talking about expect the unexpected. So there's expectations that were failed. Now we have unexpected leaders showing up. The text says in verse 4 that there was a prophetess. A prophetess. A prophet is someone who brings the word of the Lord to the people. And this particular prophet was a woman. Her name was Deborah. Now, Deborah was not only a prophetess, but she was also what we would call a judge. She sat under the palm tree at Deborah, and she settled disputes. We see this in Scripture, right? Moses had all these people coming to him with their disputes, and so he said, I can't do this all the time. I have other work to do. And so God said, you need to appoint others to help you in your work. We hear of Solomon, right? Solomon, who the people came to settle their disputes. And so he had to settle the dispute between the two women who said, this is my baby. And Solomon, in his wisdom, says, we'll cut the baby in half and you can each have half. And they said, no, don't do that. So Deborah was the person that settled disputes. She sat under a palm tree in the public, and people would come with their disputes, and others would listen and see what she decided. They considered her to be wise. They trusted her. They believed that she had words of wisdom. And then there's Barak. Barak is the warrior of Israel. And so because she is a prophet, she hears the word of the Lord and she brings it to Barak. She takes the word and says, I need to share this with Barak. And the word is, you are to gather 10,000 troops and you are to go to Mount Tabor and you are to fight against Sisera because he is cruelly oppressing us. This is the word of the Lord. And so she brings the word of the Lord to Barak. Now, the first thing we should notice is that in this patriarchal society where men are considered to be the ones responsible to lead and the ones that everybody looked to, and the men are the people we heard about the most, that all of a sudden we hear about a woman. And then notice what Barak does. He says, I will go fight Sisera, but on one condition, you have to come with me. I'm not going alone. You need to come with me. I don't dare go alone. I'm going to need your help. And so Deborah says she will, that she will go with him. So we see that you would expect Barak to be this brave man that would take this word and run with it like David did with Goliath. But no, Barak says, no. Will you help me? Will you come with me? It's unexpected. It's not what we would expect in the story. We would expect that Barak would be the brave guy, but he's not. And because of it, Deborah says, the honor will not be yours. The honor is going to be for a woman. You're not going to be the MVP, Barak. You're not going to get the Super Bowl ring. You're not going to win an Academy Award for your bravery. Someone else is going to get that honor. And it's going to be a woman. Now that's unexpected. Then the story proceeds and we see once again that there is more failed expectations. Because once Sisera hears that Israel is willing to challenge and fight him in battle, and that they have gathered 10,000 troops and they are on Mount Tabor, he gathers his 900 chariots and all the men that go along with it, and he goes and gathers in the valley, the Kishon Valley. Because it's a wide valley, and he can maneuver his chariots smoothly, and when they engage in battle, surely, Sisera is going to win. This isn't even a contest. After all, I have 900 iron chariots, and they're foot soldiers. What are they going to do to my chariots? How are they going to beat me? They're foolish to think that they could defeat me. And so Sisera goes to battle, and we don't hear it in the story, but if you read Judges 5, which is the song of Deborah after the victory, we understand and see that something happened. You see, before Barak and his men rush down the hill, and Sisera is thinking he's going to just swallow up this army as it comes down the hill to him, before that even happens, there's a thunderstorm. There's lightning. And guess what? Guess what Barak's name means? Son of lightning. There's a thunderstorm. And there is historical stories of how this valley, when it rains, because of all the water that comes through, it floods very quickly. And so there was a flood. And the iron chariots were useless. They could not maneuver. They couldn't go anywhere. They were stuck, motionless, immobile. And so the army of the Israelites, they were fleet on their feet, and they were able to attack, and they killed every person that was fighting in Sisera's army. Failed expectations. Sisera thought he was going to win. But he got defeated. And so he runs. He flees on foot. And here, so we've had failed expectations, unexpected leadership, more failed expectations, and now we have an unexpected deliverer. You see, the story tells us that Haber, the Kenite, decided to move. He up and moved his tent. And he ended up moving to a different place, and he set his tent there, and that's where he was going to live and be established. And so it just so happens that Sisera, as he is fleeing, he notices and knows where Haber lives, because Haber is a friend and a relative, and so he thinks, this is a safe place. And you know what else? If I hide in his tent, no, in his wife's tent, no one will look for me, because a man is not supposed to go into the woman's tent. Other than Haber. That's the only man that's supposed to go in Jael's tent. And so if I hide in her tent, no one's going to expect it. Expectations. No one's going to look for me there. And Jael welcomes him. She says, come on in. And he says, I'm thirsty. She gives him some milk. He's tired and worn out, and so he wants to sleep, and so she tucks him in, lets him sleep, gives him warm milk, puts some noisemakers on that help you sleep, right? Does everything. So he sleeps well, and he's sound asleep, and then she goes and finds a hammer and a tent peg, and she nails it through his skull. She kills him. Now, this is unexpected deliverance. jail is not even one of the not even an Israelite woman, not even one of the nation of Israel. She's not one of them. But she's not a Kenite either. She's married to a Kenite. And so she has no loyalty to the friendship, but she has no loyalty to Israel either. But God used jail to deliver Israel from the enemy. Now, what does this say to us? What does this say to us? If we were to look at the text and ask, what is the point of the message? You would have to go to verse 14, which is in the middle of the text, and it's Deborah's word to Barak when she says, "This is the day the Lord has given Sisera into your hands. Has not the Lord gone ahead of you?" Today is the day that the Lord has delivered us from the enemy, Satan, and has not the Lord gone ahead of us? And in this story, we see how the Lord went ahead, how He prepared, how He was maneuvering and making things happen so that this victory was possible, so that the enemy would be destroyed. Deborah, a prophetess, receives a word from the Lord. She hears it. And she passes it on to Barak. Barak won't do it unless she goes with him. And she does. Then a sudden rainstorm derails Sisera's weaponry and his plan for victory. And then a woman who Sisera thought would protect him is the same person that takes his life. Jael's tent is there because her husband decided to move. We don't know why he decided to move, but we know why he moved, don't we? God had a plan. So now look at your life. Look at your life. We claim to be Christians. We claim to believe in Jesus. Now, Jesus is not the expected Savior. The Jewish people, the chosen people, when Jesus came, this isn't the kind of Messiah we are expecting. And then, when it's proclaimed that this is the Messiah, but he comes out of Nazareth, they said, what good can come out of Nazareth? Can't be. And then when Jesus begins to teach and preach and tell them things, they say, no. We don't want anything to do with that. In fact, they get so angry with him that they say, we want to crucify him. And so we have a Savior who dies. By dying on the cross, He delivers us. That's not expected. And then He dies for us while we are still sinners. It's not like it's something we did that earned our salvation? No, it's everything God did. It's totally unexpected. And so, look at your life. The problem with us is that our expectations are generally pointed toward and geared toward what we want, what we desire. We have expectations. We have things that we want in our life, that we expect, that we work for, that we strive toward. But there is someone that is doing something in the world and in our life, and He has different expectations than us, unless we align and tune our hearts with Him. And when we tune our hearts with Him, what we used to expect, what used to be our expectations, they change. The things that we didn't expect, didn't think what could or would happen, that's what happens. So, we're going to host a serve site this summer. And all y'all are going to be helping, because we need everybody to help. And I know that many of you, if not most of you or all of you, have signed up to help in some way. And we are going to serve these kids that come. And we're going to serve our community by doing work projects and work sites. And we're going to make a difference in the world. Right? We're going to be the people serving. And what we're going to find out, all of us that are involved, what we're going to find out is that we are being served. We are trying to bless others, and in the end, when it's all said and done, if we do it the way God wants us, we're going to be the ones that are blessed. And it's going to seem like we were blessed more than the people we tried to bless. It's not expected. Every time it happens, we go, whoa, what just happened? But that's the way God works. And so this morning, we're going to come and celebrate communion. And so we've done this, many of us, for years. And we have our expectations. Maybe we've raised them high and that's never been met, so now we lower them because, you know, it's bread, it's wine, we do it. But I want you to think about this. Are those expectations what comes from our heart that is not in tune with God for our own needs? Or are they expectations that come from a heart that's in tune with God's heart, because God's expectations are what matters? And His expectation is that we would honor Him and worship Him and adore Him with all of our life. That we would surrender and submit ourselves to His authority. And so this morning I invite you, as you come to the table, to submit to God's authority. To ask Him to tune your heart to His heart so that you can receive the blessing that God intends for us to receive as we are united with Christ. Because God doesn't work in the ways that we always work. He doesn't always do things the way that we think He will or that we hope He will. Because God moves in mysterious ways, His wonders to perform, and He invites us to join Him in the mystery. And so let's do so this morning as we celebrate communion with Him. Will you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your word and for how it shows to us who You are. And when we see You at work, behind the scenes, on the front and center stage, wherever we see You at work, we are amazed. We are grateful for the work that You are doing in our hearts and in our lives. Fill us with amazement. Fill us with praise so that we may continue to expect that You will do what You say You will do and that we will find it to be mysterious but yet wonderful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.